Let me ask you first, I think we need to speak generally because we are so consumed by athletics in this country. Let's talk generally about sports participation and expectation. What estimates are there with respect to these two areas?
During the 1982-1983 year, there were approximately 3.7 million boys and 1.8 million girls participating in high school sports. Furthermore, several million children participate in sport at the junior high, middle school, and little league. One cannot help but be impressed by the intensity with which the young athletes and their parents enter sports. Indeed, the expectation level has seemingly attained unreasonable heights. People in search of college scholarships or participation at the professional level. Now there are approximately 1,365 people in the International Football League. There are about a little over 600 in Major Baseball League and about 276 players in the National Basketball Association. Only 265 rookies will be seen on all three of these leagues each year. Now, these figures are especially meaningful as regards expectation levels by athletes and the oft unreasonable expectation by parents.
We've been talking thus far about organized sports, but what about the physical fitness boom in this country, though, the so-called runner's world and the recreationist?
Yes, one cannot help but be impressed by the physical fitness boom in this country. It doesn't appear to be a fad. In all likelihood, it will persist. And so will the runners in the runner's world. Approximately 40 million people will be participating in some sporting activity each year. From a business standpoint, sports is big business. And it means a lot to a manufacturer to have an evaluation, say, by Runner's World, which can be worth millions and millions of dollars to that company that manufactures that item.
Have there been many problems with lawsuits by injured athletes, say, against the schools?
Early on, with regard to sports, the athlete was vulnerable because he or she has assumed the risk which caused the injury. But present trends in law recognize the dangers inherent in sports, but also hold those individuals responsible who were in a position to minimize the injury and failed to do so.
What are the physician's legal liabilities to the athletes and to the other persons involved?
The physician's legal liability to the athlete, the parents, the institution results from legal hindsight. You know, we have a litigious society, and the main concern should be not only with proper care and curability of the patient, but more important, the concern should be for foreseeability and preventability of injuries or aggravation of injuries and prevention of new ones.
So what's a physician to do when confronting such liability by two athletes, I guess?
Well, the physician should use his or her best judgment and should not allow financial considerations or enthusiasm for sport or the toughness to get in the treatment of sound medical advice. The physician must keep in mind the safety and well-being of the athlete. And excessive emphasis on toughness may result in avoidable injuries. This is particularly important when dealing with young athletes whose enthusiasm may exceed their judgment.
So if a physician is sued by an injured athlete, what are some of the defenses available to that physician?
When a physician is sued, he can rely on many established principles of law. First, one would like to determine the standard of care. Second, the diagnosis and treatment of the patient. Number three, understanding the hazards of that particular sport and the familiarity with sport equipment, and also understanding and foreseeability of use of sports equipment. And last, the prudence of coaches and athletes themselves.
Okay, you mentioned the standard of care that's available to physicians in sports medicine. What is that?
The standard of care applicable to all physicians is that physicians must exercise that degree of care and diligence ordinarily exercised by other physicians under same or similar circumstances. This, of course, means that the physician should possess the skill of the minimally competent physician. It doesn't refer to average skill, because a physician may, in fact, possess below average and still be possessed of the minimum skill required. Sports medicine is a recognized subspecialty in certain European countries. While this is not true in the United States, a doctor who holds himself out as a team physician may be considered a specialist and could be held to a higher or a national standard of care for failure to recognize, anticipate, and deal with risks inherent with the team sport activity. For that reason, a physician volunteering his services for sport should be extremely careful to avoid misleading the team and or parents in their reliance on his or her capabilities. When in doubt, the volunteer physician should make his or her limitations known in advance. For instance, a volunteer psychiatrist or a dermatologist may not be capable of attending to a bone fracture as another physician, and should take care to make this fact known. The care, skill, and diligence exercised under same or similar circumstances, where once compared to the local or community standard, but the modern trend is to interpret this in light of all circumstances, with geographic location merely being one element. There are several legal theories by which liability could be imposed on the physician. But in the context of sports medicine, the theory of negligence is predominant.
I understand. Would you expand then upon the physician-athlete relationship and also discuss the contractual arrangements between the physician, athlete, and third parties?
The physician will ordinarily come in contact with sport-related injuries or medical problems in two ways. One, the athlete or family may seek treatment. And two, the professional sports team or professional institution for which he or she is a team physician. The mere fact that the individual is seeking treatment as an athlete does not place the physician in a special relationship from the standpoint of the law. While all of the legal factors affecting physician-patient relationship would be present, informed consent may be more important in this circumstance, because the athlete-patient normally would be very concerned with the effect of any course of treatment or lack of treatment on his or her ability to engage in a particular sport. When the physician is under contract for a team or institution, there are additional legal obligations, making this situation analogous to where the physician is employed by a corporation as an employee. Legally speaking, physicians employed by educational institutions to treat student athletes have third-party considerations, and there is apparent problem in treating the child. The contractual arrangement is with the parent or the institution, and the subject is the treatment of the child. But if the physician retained by the school and is negligent, he could be subject to two legal actions, one by the patient athlete based on negligence, and the other by the school based on breach of contract.
What about the liabilities of physicians who examine individuals and athletes to determine their physical fitness?
Many physicians are commonly engaged in examining athletes or prospective athletes to determine their physical fitness. The general rules of law governing diagnostic procedures apply. That is, the physician is required to exercise the care and diligence commonly exercised by other physicians under same or similar circumstances. This includes the duty of the physician to do what is reasonably necessary to inform himself or herself thoroughly about the athlete and the risk of sport. This, of course, is understood to require appropriate tests and examinations. But the legal duty of the examining physician may extend beyond the physical examination. Sound judgment and good medical practice, together with liability insurance, are essential. The physician should be aware of the risks resulting from previous injury and should ensure, for example, that the previously injured ankle is properly taped, that the athlete wears high arch shoes, or if somebody is injured with the nerve, to wear shoulder pads or a neck collar, or where appropriate, the physician should insist on use of mouth protectors to prevent injuries to jaws, teeth, and nose, etc. Additionally, the sports physician who examines an athlete has a duty, a breach of which could lead to liability, to ascertain the absence of cardiovascular abnormalities with a view towards sudden death or heart attacks during strenuous exertion. And this is particularly so in individuals with known prior coronary artery disease. Furthermore, coaches, trainers, and teachers should be well versed in cardiopulmonary resuscitation. A physician's failure to train supervisory personnel in cardiopulmonary resuscitation may be viewed by the courts as negligence.
Are there other areas of potential legal liability to the sports medicine physician other than those we've talked about here?
Yes. There are areas of legal liability for the physician for failure to continuously monitor the athlete's conditioning, weight, status, vision, hearing, joint laxity, coordination, infectious disorders, and other systemic and metabolic abnormalities. Epilepsy, if well controlled, is not viewed currently as a significant impediment to sports, with the exception of boxing, tackle, football, ice hockey, diving, soccer, rugby, lacrosse, and other activities where chronic recurrent head trauma may occur. Although there are to date no reported cases, today if the physician were employed by a school or similar institution with limited funds, then if the physician deems appropriate that a certain test is needed, and those in charge say we don't have the money, then we do have problems. In such a case, the physician's judgment of what is needed should prevail. Anything less would be a breach of the duty owed to the athlete patient.
Let me ask you this. Are there legal standards of care set by the courts in sports medicine, or are the physicians governed only by the medical standards of care?
In general, physicians are governed by medical standards of care. But it is particularly important for physicians to keep abreast of legal standards. The case of Rosenzweig illustrates the difference between medical and legal standards. In that case, a boxer who had been examined as certified as fit to engage in a fight died after being knocked out. Autopsy revealed brain injury from previous injuries. These were undetected by prior doctors. At that time, the common medical practice of boxing was for the practicing physician to defer to the opinions of the previous physician that examined the individual most recently. Now, although this was the prevailing medical standard of care, The court held that it was deficient, and it did not conform to the legally required standard of care. This result was at odds with the general rule by which the standards set by the medical profession are usually accepted as the proper standards by the court. The Rosenzweig case was reversed on appeal, but it still serves as an example of the pitfalls facing the physician engaged in sports medicine.
I think all of us have become increasingly aware of drugs and sports. And I think a particularly dangerous problem area lies in the administration of drugs to the athletes. What are your comments in the matter of drugs and athletes?
Administration of drugs to athletes has been the subject of much media coverage, but it hasn't been yet ruled upon in court decisions. The scenario in such cases usually involves a player injured slightly in an athletic contest who is allowed to continue to play in either the same or subsequent game while drugs are being administered by the physician primarily for masking pain. The injury is subsequently aggravated and the lawsuit is brought by the injured athlete. Now, there are three legitimate uses of drugs in athletes. One, maintenance treatment, for example, use of thyroid or insulin. Number two, medications for an acute injury in an attempt to restore normalcy, for example, analgesics and sometimes even steroids. And third, for prophylaxis, for example, administration of antibiotics when one member of the group develops meningitis.
In the time allotted, we've covered a kind of a broad area here, and I think sports medicine is that way right now. I wonder if you would care to, because it would certainly be helpful to me, if you could make some concluding remarks about this whole area we're talking about.
Well, the area of supervision of athletes covers a broad area, beginning with the physical examination before engaging in sports, and extending to the diagnosis, treatment, and rehabilitation of the injured. Prevention of sport injuries may be achieved in large measure by balancing the ability and conditioning of the athlete vis-a-vis the rigors, demands, and risks of his sport, and careful consideration of all circumstances, including a highly detached view of the athlete's ability, which is distinctly different from his toughness or desire to win. This will go a long way for helping the physician to avoid the imposition of legal liability.